Hi, welcome to the Signal Path. I have another repair episode for you guys, or at least an attempted repair. I actually just started recording this and I was going over the first introduction and I accidentally erased about 2.5-3 minutes of video where I first talked about this and I started to take it apart and I haven't done it yet, but anyhow, I lost the footage. So let me go over what I was saying before. So this is a Rohde Schwarz FSH3, which is a 100 kHz to 3 GHz portable spectrum analyzer. These are battery powered and they can also run from external AC power source and so on. And they are supposed to be used in the field when you want to just monitor some spectrum. Typically these are pretty good in terms of performance and there's a bunch of them available on eBay. This was sold as non-working, as a unit that doesn't power on. It didn't have a power supply, it didn't have a battery, it didn't have anything. But it was fairly inexpensive, so I decided to pick it up and try and see if it can be repaired. You know, but once I received it, I noticed a couple of things. First of all, it is filthy. I'm fairly sure that this was just taken out of the bottom of some dumpster somewhere. I didn't pay very much for it, but I'm a little bit disappointed. The second thing is that it looks like it has taken quite a beating. You can see there's a crack here on the side. Unfortunately, the pictures on eBay, there was only a picture of the face of it like this. You know, it looked fine, so I just went ahead and bought it. But it is in pretty bad shape. It's very, very dirty, as you can see. And I'm going to have to clean it extensively. But since it is in really bad shape, I'm not going to clean it before I actually fix it, because it may not be really repairable. So I started taking it apart, and I just took apart the very top part of it, which is just a panel that basically sits over here. So I took this apart, and you know, I took a bunch of screws, and I was about to show you that when I lost the footage. Anyhow, and when I took it apart, I noticed something else. So here at the top of the unit, this is where the RF input is, as well as some external power and so on. There is a plug here that plugs in like this. I just took that out as well. And one side of it is an audio output, and this side of it is supposed to be the AC plug, but it didn't even have an AC plug, and that wasn't also listed in the description. So anyhow, even more disappointment, but it's kind of interesting. You can see how much effort they've put into putting this ferromagnetic cores to just filter these lines as much as possible, because they're outside of the unit and obviously you want to block as much interference as you can. But anyhow, so this is where the power would normally go. I'm not sure why it's missing, but anyhow, when I started, this doesn't really fill me with a lot of confidence because of these issues, because it means that someone has already taken a whack at this, and I'm not sure if it's even missing any components. Anyhow, now you're up to date on what was missing from the beginning of the video. So I'm going to take it apart a little bit more, and we'll take a look and see what disaster we find on the inside. And here's the unit with the back cover removed, and I also removed a couple more screws to remove this aluminum back, and again I noticed that it was missing some screws. It didn't have everything in there, which is rather disappointing again. And you can look here that this ribbon cable wasn't even plugged in. Now, I don't believe this is a very critical ribbon cable, because it's just probably connects to this auxiliary port here, which is for external triggering, for an external power sensor. It's for a Rohde Schwarz power sensor, which I don't actually have any of those. But anyway, I think that's what that is for. So probably not very important for it not being powering on. And there we go. If I go ahead and remove that, and there we go, take a look. The board itself looks fairly clean. It doesn't look like it has any physical damage to it right off the bat. This cable is clearly the power cable, which was coming from the front here. And the board construction is, as to be expected, a complete two-board design. You have all the digital processor and everything on one side, and all the RF and microwave components here. So the super-heterodyne down converter, plus the mixers, plus the PLL, and the multiple actually PLL domains that something like this would need. All of them is enclosed in this chassis here that is screwed shut, of course, because this is an RF section. And once the down conversion is completed, and actually look at this cable, I would say even the analog to digital conversion is most likely completed. They send the digital data over. I don't believe they send any analog data. I have to take a closer look, perhaps by opening this to know for sure. But everything else is fairly clear. Here's the backlight connector. I actually took out this cable while I was trying to remove the aluminum. This is the cable that goes to the LCD. I removed it because I wanted to make sure I don't damage it. And you can see the ribbon cable that goes to the keyboard here. And this piece is basically just ground, and it hugs over this area to go over the high voltage that runs the backlight tube. And here's some DC converter power domain. Here's some filtering here, and some processor, some Atmel, and something else here, which I don't immediately recognize. But anyhow, we have to take it apart a little bit more to take a look. Now, I do happen to actually have a battery. This did not come with this unit, but this is a typical battery. These are 7.2 volt nickel metal hydride batteries that are very common in these type of handheld devices. The construction of this looks very much like the Fluke, and this is actually a battery from my Fluke scope meter thing. So I can go ahead and plug it in and use this cable conveniently broken into two individual cables, and I can connect it to my power supply and run it and see what kind of, if it draws any power and see if it powers on or not. It's connected to the keyboard, obviously. So if I were to, you know, press that, oops, something just fell out. What was that? Oh, look at this, a broken piece of plastic just fell out of the unit. Who knows where that came from? Well, whatever it came from, let's see if there's anything else. No, yeah, there you go, something else fell out. This little piece of plastic is just full of surprises. Obviously, as I said, someone had just tossed this into garbage, and probably someone picked it up and tried to sell it. Ah, disappointing purchase. It's probably one of my most disappointing eBay purchases. I guess I've been lucky to this point, if this is the worst that can happen. And yeah, so there it is. Let's go and plug it in and see if it turns on. And obviously not going to turn on, but at least it's worth a try. And here we go, I connected the battery to the unit. This battery is actually the same battery that is used by the Fluke scope meters, and it's the same thing as 7.2 volt nickel metal hydride type of battery. It's very common. The whole structure of this is very similar to the Fluke scope meter. They're all built on around essentially the same chassis. And anyhow, I've connected it here to the power conveniently with the exposed wires, and I've connected that to my RIGO supply here, and the supply is set to 18 volts, which I believe is the power supply for this unit. I just looked it up online, and I go ahead and turn it on. What do we see here? There we go. 0.575 amps, about 10.8 watts or so, which is good. It means that it's drawing power and most likely charging the battery, because this battery was definitely not fully charged. So it looks like it's okay. I also connected the screen cable as well, obviously, otherwise we won't be able to see anything. Let's see, see if I can turn this around without damaging anything any more than it's already damaged. Press the power button, let's see. Oh, nothing. Of course not. That would have been too easy. Nope. No life at all. No matter how many times I press it, how I press it, nothing at all. And I put the battery in and connected it to the AC supply, so there's no question what's going on. Well, from the mechanical shock that this has received, let me turn the power off here. From the mechanical shock it's received, I don't know what condition the buttons and the ribbon cables are. I think it would be a good place to start is take it apart even further and look at to see if these buttons actually create a signal here on these ribbon cables. Because if the power button doesn't interact with the unit, obviously it's not going to turn on. It might be a good place to start, and it will also give us a chance to take it apart completely and have kind of everything exposed without the chassis and see if there's any more damage in there. Because when I flipped it over, you know, these other pieces of plastic fell out of it, so obviously something bad is going on. So let's see, let's take it apart more. And here's the main unit separated, and you can get a better look at what's going on here in the power section. So here's where the battery plug obviously goes in, and we should be able to monitor from the other side of the board, make sure everything's making contact. And I'm going to take a look and see what all these ICs are. There is a little bit of a botch going on over there. Obviously someone has but this looks like this is a manufacturing correction. This is not something someone has done, obviously, and this kind of care is put into it, obviously, from the manufacturer. So we have to take it apart. A little bit more, nothing there. Interesting, some exposed area, obviously, to expose these pads here, perhaps for some factory programming testing or checking or something. But other than that, this side of it looks good, and yet again it's missing another screw, another problem, which I do not like to see. Missing screws are not a good sign. And let's see here, let me put this away without breaking it anymore. And yeah, here we go. This is where the LCD and the key would be, the panel would be. We can take it apart one step further from these screws. Here we go. There you go, I usually don't record me taking things apart, but this doesn't look like to have too many screws. There we go, that's good. And let's see, oh, there's two more screws here. Yeah. Well, take a look at this. That isn't that just wonderful? Let me see. And of course the other side. Yep, the other side's also broken. Perfect. Could this thing be broken any more than it is? Yeah, there you go. The standoff, the plastic standoffs are broken. Here's the LCD screen. Looks good. You see my reflection? Yeah, other than that, doesn't seem to be any major problem with it. Okay, well, let's put that aside. And this is the directional encoder, which is this thing in the front panel. And, interesting. It doesn't look like I can actually disassemble this any further without somehow eliminating this. Let me see, figure out if I can take that directional encoder off so we can disassemble without having to unsolder these cables. Alright, that's successful. Easy to take that off. And this is just a protective panel, you can see, with some spring shields on the side. And here's our buttons, the interface of the buttons. There you go. Yeah, it looks pretty good. I don't think there is any major problem with it, actually. And looks like that the connections are okay. So one easy way to find out, I see a... Sorry, I didn't realize it wasn't in the screen. I do see a little kink on this. I wonder if that matters. Well, the easiest way to find that is just to check for some connectivity. That's pretty easy. Plus, that kink may not even be where the power connector is. So if this is sitting this way, where's the power? This is the power. So there's our power button. And you can see that it actually has a designated trace, it appears to me. I'm sorry, I'm just looking at this right now for the first time myself. So these two outer traces, which will boil down to these two lines there, is our power cable. So we might be able to just take this out. That is, if I can. Oh no, the buttons are all individual. Are they? Or not? Ah, that's kind of funny. The buttons are, wow, this thing is dirty. I think I'm gonna need a shot of antibiotics after I'm done with this. It is very, very dirty. But anyhow, this is good because it's not taken apart this much to this extent, meaning that if, in the unlikely case that it can be repaired, I should be able to wash everything thoroughly before I put it together. So there's the front. You can see the screen is just disgusting. And I'm not sure how many scratches it has on it, but it is certainly gonna need cleaning. So, here we go. Looks good, I would say. Looks kind of funny doing it this way. Putting it like that. Well, there's our panel. So we should be able to push it and figure out if it works. So here we go. I've put the panel down here, so we should be able to measure some resistance. Just keep in mind that these things are kind of deposited on there, and they are very fragile. And if you push too hard with your multimeter, you can actually scratch them and they will come off. And also, don't expect a perfect short. They are resistive, as you don't need a perfect short to close a soft switch like that. You just need, you know, a couple of hundred ohms would be enough just to be able to change the logic level at an input of some gate. And I've also set my multimeter to a manual range of 500 ohms, so it doesn't have to basically spend too much time auto-ranging. So let's go ahead and measure a trace just on one side of the two ends of here. I'm sorry if you can't directly see it on the screen. I'm just basically, let me as an example show you here, I'm just measuring a resistance across one of these traces, but just on the power panel. So what do I see here? It doesn't seem to be very conductive. Come on, let's try the other side. Let's see, oh, there we go. 22 ohms across the trace itself. Let's go from the input cable directly to one of them. There you go. So this is from the input of the cable to one side of the switch. Now if I go from the other side of the cable to here, I don't see anything. No, wait. There you go. It seems like it's not the greatest connection in the world. But you know, I have measured these before, and I have seen, yeah, there it is, it's about 50, 60 ohms, so maybe it's not so bad. Sometimes they don't make very good contact, and you may think that, oh, this is not working, but it actually is not an issue. But you know what, instead of trying to measure directly over here, which is not a bad idea, but there's even a simpler idea that we can try. I'm going to, since we know which two pins are the power pins, this is the power switch, we know that these two first pins have to be shorted together in order to initiate a power on. Why don't we just do that on the connector? It's pretty easy, the connector is exposed, and we can easily just do that. Might save us some time, and it will be anyhow more interesting looking at the main board rather than this piece of plastic. Let's just do that. So I thought let's take this apart one step further, which will make it a little bit easier also. We can take a closer look. So here's the entire RF section. As I was saying, all the conversion, frequency conversion is going to be handled in here. The clock domain is also, obviously the LO domain is also all in there. It's pretty straightforward. I'm going to take it apart anyway, even if we fix it, so we can take a look inside it and compare it to its block diagram, because the block diagram of this section is actually available. I just take a look at the service manual. Unfortunately, that's the only thing that's available, just a block diagram of this section, basically. And here's the digital board, which I have disconnected. As we saw before, fairly straightforward. If I find my pointer here. And this is, by the way, the infrared port. There's one crystal here, and that crystal is 3.6 megahertz. Now remember that there has to be some clock live on this in order for the soft power switch to work. So it has a dedicated microcontroller just monitoring the power in the background, so you know that it handles the charging and of the battery and the power switch and so on. And there's actually another crystal up here, which I think is 30 megahertz or so. I can't see exactly, but that's right there. It's clearly connected to this component here. And there's a bunch of more memory and so on, a whole bunch of DC-DC converters and filters. This is where the DC power would come into the unit, so we can directly actually connect the external power to here. We don't need to go through the other board. And here's where the keyboard would be connected, so we're going to short those pins together manually. And on this side, we have more parts. There's it. See, I knew there was something familiar with this. There's a fluke part right here. So this design is very similar to what is on the scope meters, I believe, which means that maybe the schematic of the scope meter can be of some help. I think that these are very similarly designed. And here's a whole section full of devices around. Take a closer look here. You can see we can probably trace the power. This is where the power comes in. We can trace it. Here's the filter, and here's, you know, one of the ports goes in here and goes out. And yeah, we should be able to take a look at it and see what's going on. Everything looks good. You can see another botch here that they have done, another thing that they have corrected because of some design error. And there's an interesting sideway resistor here. Everything else looks good. And yeah, hold on a second. Look at here. Uh-oh. That does not look good. I don't know how well it shows up on camera. I mean, try hold it steady. You see that? There's definitely some burn marks on this. Oh no, because I have no idea what that component actually is. That's unfortunate. I'm gonna have to investigate a little bit further. I wasn't expecting that. Alright, we're gonna have to scratch the shorting of the power at the moment, because we have to go ahead and figure out what that component actually is. So here's the board under my microscope. I'm sorry that I'm hand holding the camera here. I just wanted to quickly show you this. And there it is. This looks what it looks like. So now the numbers are fairly clear to read. It says 651. So this is a good place to start. You can clearly see the big damage that's happened here. So it's obviously something has gone terribly, terribly wrong with it. So I'm going to go ahead and do a couple of more searches and see what I can find out, and see if we can figure out what this component is and whether it's critical in the power on sequence. And here's the component that's been damaged. And this is actually just an NMOS transistor that has an R-on of about 90 milliohms, which is fairly small at a VGS of 4.5 volts. And it can support up to 3.2 amps of drain source current and a breakdown voltage of 30 volts. And here's this footprint. It's a SOT-23-6 type of package. And this is obsolete. I couldn't find this anymore. But I just looked around my kind of stack of parts here, and I have actually a few of these, and these are the same package, except that this type of NMOS transistor doesn't support as much current as the one that's on the board. This is only a 1 amp current, and these guys have a very, very large junction to ambient thermal resistance, about 60 2.5 Celsius per watt, which is quite a lot. So you cannot really overdrive them because the package is so small. So naturally, the thermal resistance is quite high. But everything else is about the same. It has a 90 milliohm of RDS on and so on. And so one of the things I was thinking of doing, it was actually stacking two of these on top of each other and soldering them on top of each other in the place of the old one to double the current handling capability of it. And they will essentially just be in parallel. And since these are just MOSFETs, you can put them in parallel without any problems. And see what happens. Now, this doesn't mean that it's gonna fix our problem, and either way, we're gonna have to change this anyway, regardless of whether this solves the power on problem or not. But it is likely that it is part of the power management system, because if you have a MOSFET like this, you know, specifically designed as a switch, basically, and it's likely that it is part of that system. So it would be a good place to start. So I'm gonna go ahead and unsolder this guy. Where was it? Right here. I'm going to unsolder this and clean the pads a little bit and put one or two of these on top of each other, solder it on, connect it up, and see what happens. Again, I'm not going to film the soldering part because I assume, you know, you guys are fairly familiar with removing and putting something so small back on. It's pretty straightforward. So let's go ahead and I'll show you what happens. And here we have the part removed. It looks pretty good. The pads are fairly intact. It's right here in the center of the screen, of course. And you can see clearly the footprint and how the traces are connected between the common pins on the package. So I'm going to go and put one of the ones that I have in here. And here is the replaced part. If you take a look, you can see that there is a missing pin there. That pin is actually a drain, but of course here there's a trace coming from this part to this part, which will be the source connected. This doesn't, it only has one source pin. So there it is, and this actually not having that pin further degrades the thermal integrity of the package. But anyhow, let's just stick with it. I only put one on this. I'm curious to try it out and see what happens, if it makes any difference at all, and then we can continue debugging if it still doesn't turn on. Well, I assembled everything and connected everything together, plugged in the battery into the unit, and puff, the smoke came out. We're back to square one. Isn't it amazing how remarkably similar this looks than the one that I just removed? It basically blew up exactly the same way as before. So, obviously, this guy has a short on one side and a large voltage, probably the voltage of the battery, appearing on the other side. But the gate, I would have imagined, would be grounded, or at least when the unit is powered off completely, unless this is a portion of the circuit that needs to be maintained when initially the battery is connected. So I'm a little puzzled exactly what this failure means. So which means that it's going to require further investigation, whether this is just part of the battery problem or is it actually part of the main power supply. This could also be an issue if there is a short in one of the ICs that's supposed to be always powered on. And I believe that the power management IC down here is actually always powered on, even when the unit is connected to the battery and there's nothing else. Anyway, it's not powered on completely, meaning that it's not booting. So anyhow, well, let's go ahead and trace that. I'm going to remove the MOSFET one more time, and this time we're going to plug it into the battery upside down so I can actually measure the voltages on those ports so we can get an idea of what the voltages are across those gates of that device. And we can even have fly wires coming out of it and measure how much current would normally go through it, and then kind of go from there and see what happens. So I think we're onto something, even though we took a step backwards, but still kind of interesting. Well, let's take a closer look at this. I just spent a few minutes looking at this a bit more, and I think I understand what's going on now. So this transistor here, you can see that a part of it is connected to this copper pore here, and the other part is connected across these two resistors. Now, the other side of this resistor here, that's actually ground. So these resistors, I measure them, they're very small. They're less than 0.1 ohm. They're about maybe 0.12 or something. And I probably, with my contact resistance inaccuracy, I would say these are 0.1 ohm resistors. So this means that this must be some kind of a current monitor port where you can measure. You can see a small wire coming out of it. And that means that they're monitoring this voltage. So, and we were going to ask, well, what is this pin connected to? Well, if I flip it over, that pin is actually connected to this transformer. So now it begins to make sense. This is part of the switching transistor of a flyback converter, which means that there is the coil of this is obviously on one side is going to be connected to the voltage of the battery, and on the other side is going to be connected to the switching transistor to the ground, and this is the monitoring current, which monitors how much current goes through that transistor, and that transistor is supposed to have PWM on it and so on, just like a, you know, a boost converter or buck converter type of application. Then you will see that it's going to modulate the current in here, and the transformer on the other side is going to pick it up, and it's going to have some voltage developed on it, and that voltage can be monitored, blah blah blah. That's just basic DC-DC converter theory from there on. So it looks like to me that indeed this is connected, therefore connected to from this side, and the other side of the transformer coil is actually here. So this, I verified just now that this is indeed connected to the battery terminal up there. So now it begins to make sense. And at the time when you initially power it on, this gate was at VDD, I'm assuming to start the current in the transformer, and then it would begin to do PWM. So a couple of things. It is possible that the circuitry that generates the PWM and controls the voltage and so on is broken. Therefore, the transistor is fully turned on, drawing so much current directly through the coil of the transformer that it burns up. Second possibility is that the transistor that I installed, which was only rated for 1 amp, was simply not powerful enough to run the DC-DC converter, and it just died, and it has nothing to do with the failure of the system in general. I'm a little bit reluctant, but that's a possibility. So I think an easy way for me to go forward would simply be to connect some flywires out of this and connect a bigger transistor in there that will surely be able to withstand the current and see what happens, and if it indeed is still going to try put a crazy amount of current through it, and then we can see if this PWM actually even works at all. That's kind of what my guess is. Again, I just looked at it only for a couple of minutes, but I think that's probably what is happening considering what's over here. So next step, solder some wires to this, bring it out and see. By the way, the reason this has to run is because it needs to generate the voltages in order for a component in here to run. So I'm gonna explain this as quickly as I can. The clock circuitry for the power management is actually in here. So you need to be able to power something in here in order to generate the clock, which then comes back and powers this guy. So it looks like that this system has to somehow run this PWM circuitry and the flyback converter even when it's not powered on completely. Not 100% sure about that. Sounds a little bit unusual to me that that would be the case, which is what scares me a little bit, because it kind of points to the fact that perhaps the circuitry that's supposed to control this is not working and it's just stuck to VDD, and that is what burns the transistor no matter what happens. And the only way to find out is to do a few more experiments. So let's go ahead and see what happens. Alright, here we are. There's actually one thing I forgot to mention. There's also the possibility that the transformer itself is bad, of course, and there's a short in it, and then if you turn the switching transistor on, you're going to destroy the transistor. Now, I measured the DC resistance of the coil, and it's really, really small, but the wires are quite thick, and I'm not sure how many turns there are. I haven't measured the inductance yet, which is, of course, the part that matters, but we can get there if you need to figure out if the problem is definitely with the coil or not. I hope not, because this is looks to be a custom part. I don't think I can easily find a replacement for it. But anyhow, so here we go. We have our gate, our source, and our drain connection connected to three wires over here, which I'm going to flip on this side. So now I should be able to just connect these to the oscilloscope and monitor the DC voltage and the AC voltage and see what's going on, if the PWM is being applied or not. First, I'll do it without connecting this, just so that we can see if the internal clock of the power management IC starts up, which it needs to, in order to power everything on, and then other clocks can take over for the other functions. So let's go ahead and try it. I'm gonna have to use my oscilloscope up here, and my CAT scan, which is always active. There we go. So let's go ahead and try that, see what happens. Here we go, I plugged in the battery, and I connected the oscilloscope probes to the source as well as the drain. Now here is where I expect a large voltage. I expect the supply voltage of the battery essentially, and indeed that's what I'm getting. And if you look at this this waveform here, it's a steady waveform, it's a DC signal, and this is a 5 volt reference here, and it's sitting all the way up there, and I can go ahead and add for example an average voltage to it. An average voltage, if I can find it, that is, where are you, average voltage, here you are. There it is, it says 8 volts, which is the supply voltage of the battery. So that makes sense. Now I'm gonna just keep it here on the scope, and I'm gonna switch from the drain voltage to now the gate voltage. So we're gonna measure the gate source voltage here. Okay, get this, plug this in here. If I can get it steady, the camera is in the way. There we go, and what do we have? Aha, look at that, that looks good. That is a PWM signal, and you can see that it's mostly on. It spends most of its time being on. The duty cycle is quite high, and the reason for that, of course, is because the circuit is trying to start up the DC-DC converter, so it spends quite a bit of time high. So during that time, it's going to draw a lot of current, and then it switches back on. And this PWM cycle should automatically adjust once the other side of the transformer reaches the desired voltage. So that's, again, to be expected. So far, it looks good. I can also plot the duty cycle. You can see the duty cycle is 67%. So naturally, as you can see, and there's already a little bit of a duty cycle on it. You can see that it kind of changes around, so it's definitely active, it's trying to do something. That's a good sign. It means that part of that circuit is at least alive. So I should be able to now go ahead and try it with another transistor. Now I happen to have some more transistors here, and these MOS transistors actually are able to handle a lot more current. Now they don't have as small of a on resistance, but they do certainly have current carrying capability, which is much more than the current carrying capability of the other one. So I should be able to just go ahead and solder one of these to these three terminals, and it's going to hang out in there. But what I'm going to also do is I'm going to put a resistor in series with it to limit the current intentionally, and that will allow us to also measure the voltage across the resistor and see the PWM current being induced in the transformer. And if there is a problem with the transformer, that will be the way to detect it. So this is a good place to start. Let me go ahead and prepare this, solder some resistors on here, and I'll be right back. So here's our setup, and the setup is really simple. All I've done is that I have connected a MOS transistor here, which can carry a lot more current, like the one I showed you before. And in series with its drain is a 5 ohm resistor. This is two 10 ohm resistors on parallel, just creating 5 ohms. And I'm monitoring the voltage across the 5 ohm resistor with my oscilloscope probes with the ground and on the one on the other side. Now the PWM signal that we saw that's supposed to go on the gate of the MOSFET is going to drive this MOSFET, and it's going to turn it on and off, and that's going to induce some current in the coil, which then has no other place to go but to go through the resistor. Now this is obviously not a way to run a DC-DC converter, because if you put a large series resistor, especially in a buck converter, in series with a coil, you're going to kill its efficiency, and on top of that, it may not even properly start because it has such a large DC resistance. So what could potentially happen in a situation like this is that the DC-DC converter is just going to continue to try to get started and never fully succeed. The purpose of this is not to run it like this, but I just wanted to see how much current would go through this resistor, and because in theory, you know, if I have about 8 volts or so across it and I have about 5 volts of resistance, I should be able to get at maximum over 1 amp of current easily going through this. So, which means that I expect the PWM to start and put some current through it. I want to see if the MOSFET survives and if everything else kind of stays the same. So that's really easy to test. I haven't plugged in the battery yet. I've also connected it to the AC source. I haven't turned on the AC source, but you know, by plugging the battery in and out continuously, I'm discharging it. So I want to be able to then charge it at some point. Right now there is no AC signal coming in. But I mean there is no DC power coming in. Only the battery is going to be live. So I'm going to go ahead and look at the oscilloscope screen here, and what I will do is that I will plug in the battery and we can see what happens. I'm also plotting the average voltage here as well as the duty cycle, but you know, maybe it would be worthwhile to also plot the peak-to-peak voltage. There we go, that should help. So let's go ahead and plug this in and see what happens here. Here we go. Aha, that's not bad. There it is. Here our pulse is this sharp pulses that you see is because of the inductive behavior of the coil there. And you can see that the duty cycle is 92%, average voltage of 6 volts, which means over 1 amp on average, and a peak-to-peak voltage of 20. It says 20 is because of the really rapid falling edges. It obviously doesn't go to plus or minus 20 volts. But anyhow, that's interesting, which means there's more than an amp going through it. And since the duty cycle is so high, it means that it's trying to start the buck converter, the flyback converter, I mean, and it's not able to. So it's putting a maximum duty cycle. Under this condition, obviously, everything will eventually die because there's so much current. And remember, this is not turned on. This is not sustainable. You don't expect the... If the circuit is functional, you don't expect it to do this with the battery plugged in. If it does this with the battery plugged in, it won't last at all in standby. It will die within a couple of hours completely. So this is not the way. So, but this is promising in a way that if I go back down here, there's no smoke anymore. So this MOSFET is able to easily handle the current, even though it doesn't have a heatsink on it. And I'm not even showing you the MOSFET. There we go. This MOSFET right here can easily survive. So far looks good. I don't see any major issue. So what I would like to do now is to short the battery out with a piece of wire. Let me see what I have here. There you go, maybe something like this. Short it out completely, and then we can look at the PWM signal that's on the gate. Remember, this is the current we're looking at, not the PWM signal through the gate. Let me also disconnect this battery because I'm discharging it very quickly here. There we go. So I can go ahead. Wow, that's hot. So I can go ahead and look at the gate voltage and with respect to the source voltage. So we will see the VGS, which is the PWM signal of the buck converter switch, blah, blah, blah. And then we can look at it on the oscilloscope, and I can short it, and we can see if the duty cycle changes. If the duty cycle changes, that means that the flyback converter is definitely doing something. It's able to regulate the current. That would be a very interesting and definitive test to see at least if that portion of the circuit is working. So let me go ahead and try that out. All right, so in this setup, I'm now going to look at the source and the gate voltage, as you can see here, plugged in with the oscilloscope very carefully. And I'm gonna try again with the battery so we can see the gate source voltage, because that will be much more interesting to see in anyway. And let's see, this is with the resistor in series, so we expect to see a very high duty cycle. There it is. You can see the duty cycle is quite high. Let me go here so you can see it. I think that's what it's doing, is trying to start the DC-DC converter, and it can't. So now I'm going to go ahead and unplug the battery. There we go, and it stops. I'm gonna now short out the resistor completely. So there we go, you can take a quick look. Resistor has been shorted out, the battery is disconnected. We go back to the scope, and I'm gonna try and take a single trigger here so we can see the startup sequence. And there, there we go. Look at this, look, that's beautiful. That's exactly what I wanted to see. You can see that it's trying, it starts up the DC converter. The duty cycle is quite different. Now it's only 28%, so the average current is gonna be much, much, much smaller. Let's see, and it keeps going. Oh, and the memory, we ran out of memory. And then, oh, look at that, there's nothing. It turns it back off. That's interesting. So it actually turned itself back off. I wasn't expecting that. Let's try again. I'm gonna unplug the battery. I'm gonna plug in the battery. It briefly turns on, checks it, and then takes it back off. Something must power on, and then it turns itself off. There you go, that makes more sense. It makes sense not to run that PWM when this circuit is in standby, of course, because otherwise it would completely drain the battery. This is a very good sign. It means that I should be able to go ahead and completely remove this resistor and just solder the wires directly to this MOS transistor here, and then see if we can try and turn it on and see if it powers back on. That should be fairly interesting. All right, everything put back together. Here's my transistor. I just wrapped it in some tape, but essentially I removed the resistor, nothing more. It's just kind of hanging there. I put the tape on it so that it doesn't accidentally touch any of the other components and not cause any more damage. This thing is already in pretty bad shape. So yeah, I connected the screen, and let's go ahead and plug in the battery. See if the smoke comes out of it. There we go. Aha, beautiful. Of course, we expected nothing to happen. It powered on! It powered on its own. I'm not sure why, but it did. Fantastic, look at that. Isn't that awesome? There it is. Actually, I didn't even have the keyboard connected to it, so I had forgotten that already. I could have, I guess, just pushed a button. That's fantastic. It just came back to life. Wait a second, I should be able to turn it off. Let me see, yeah, I think it was over here. There it is, I can turn it off. Can I turn it back on? I can, look at that, that's beautiful. It's great. It's unfortunately it's not a touch screen, but isn't that amazing? There it is. It's working. That's great. Now I'm not sure if it's going to be able to display a signal or not, whether it's any other way damaged or not. But let's give you the view of the screen here. There it is. So the problem was the transistor on the buck converter, and the first transistor that I installed simply did not have the instantaneous current handling for it to start up correctly. I think that was the issue. So that's okay, not a problem. We learned quite a bit by looking and kind of reverse engineering that it was an interesting thing anyway. So I guess what I can do is I can get one type N connector, connect the type N connector over here, and take that to my synthesizer just so we can see if it actually can display signals from DC to 3 GHz. And if it can, then I can focus on cleaning the case and putting it back together and gluing it and all that, which I will show you the final result. Oh, and there's one other thing I still want to do. I promised to go over the design of the RF section. So I will go over the design of the RF section with the block diagram so we can see exactly how this is built. Should be pretty interesting, educational anyway. Hopefully you're still watching. Let me know if you're still watching up to this point, and then if the tutorial on how the RF section works would be of interest as well afterwards if you're still around. So I'm gonna go ahead and connect the type N. Let's see if you see something. And here we go. I connected it to my synthesizer up here, which you've seen before. It's the Rohde DSG3060. So let's go ahead and take a look at the screen here. There we go. I'm gonna try and display a 1 GHz signal. Let's see. And there it is. Beautiful. Here's our 1 GHz signal right there. Of course, I cannot change the settings because there is no keyboard, but I should be able to change the frequency. We can, oh, there you go. Did I change it? No, not yet. Let's see. Let me go to, let's say, go up by 100 MHz. There it is. Look at that. Perfect. He has no problem. And if I go all the way to, that's the end of the screen, that's 3 GHz. And if I go all the way back to the beginning of the screen, there it is. And you can see some second harmonic there from the synthesizer, I believe. And yeah, looks pretty good. So now the only other thing I need to do is to clean up the case, close it. Now, I need to decide what to do with this guy. Now this is in the air and I'm actually touching it. And oh wow, it's quite hot actually. So definitely during operation, this guy is going to get hot. Now, one of the reasons why this particular one is so hot, but the original one that came with it would be better off, is because this one has a much higher R-on. It has a much higher on resistance. Actually, maybe more than, I would say, it says in the datasheet this is about 1.2 ohms, which is much more than the 90 milliohm from the original one. So if I were to, once I receive the original component, I can put it back in and solder it on, and that one should be fine, because as you know, the RDS on times the current through it is going to be the voltage developed across the device, and that's going to determine the power consumption. So if I were to put the original part in, it should do much, much better. But for now, it works, so this is pretty promising. So next step would be, let me just clean everything up and clean the case and all that, because I need to do that anyway, and then we'll go over the design of what's in here. So here's a block diagram of the RF section. Actually, this is a block diagram of the entire instrument, and we'll look at the block diagram of the RF section separately in more detail. And so I can just quickly go over this to give you a general idea of what is happening inside this unit. So at the very bottom here is where the digital board is. It's the board that we were basically looking at, trying to figure out what the issue was and repairing it. And you can see that obviously there's a RISC processor at the core of it. There is some program memory, data memory, flash and RAM and so on. And there's the optical interface, which has an infrared cable that you can connect and talk to the unit externally. Power management is the IC that was controlling the PWM. Here's the battery that has a temperature sensor in it and so on, and all the interface and so on. So nothing very interesting here. But this is the RF section, and the RF section is broken into multiple parts, when the main part is, of course, the synthesizer at the bottom here, and at the top we have the RF chain. This is a super-heterodyne converter. It has three IF, so it's a three-stage conversion, plus a delta sigma ADC and buffers and so on that follows it. Now, this section that you see up here is for the 6 GHz version, and the only difference between the 6 GHz version and the 3 GHz version is this doubling of the LO signal that ultimately just changes the secondary and second and third IF signals that would come out of the instrument. So this is the only difference. Other than that, there is really nothing else that changes between them. So the input arrives from here. There's some protection and low-pass filtering that happens first. Then it goes through the first converter, the second converter, the third converter before it's digitized. The first converter is actually an up converter. It up converts the signal from 0 to 3 GHz all the way to 4031 MHz. So it up converts to about 4 GHz. And then the 4 GHz signal is down converted to 801.25 MHz, and then down converted once again to 31.25 MHz before it can be before you can go in and get digitized. So this chain is very common. You've seen me talk about this quite a few times for different synthesizers. They all essentially rely on a very similar super-heterodyne architecture. Now the synthesizer is broken into two completely independent synthesizers. The first synthesizer is a 4 to 7 gigahertz variable synthesizer. The second one is a fixed 3.2 gigahertz synthesizer. And that makes sense because this is the job of the first converter to center the signal of interest around 4031 megahertz. So this signal of interest is constant at its frequency, at its IF. And the second converter just down converts it again. That's why these are different. And then the third converter is actually coherent to the second LO because it just uses a divide by four. So these are coherent LO. This one is not directly coherent, not at RF at least, but it is coherent at the reference frequency of 10 megahertz, which locks everything together. So here we have our 10 megahertz temperature controlled crystal oscillator, which then of course acts as the reference for everything. And there is also an option to have a tracking generator, which this unit is not equipped with, but if it were, then it would have its own local oscillator, which can also sweep between 3 to 4 gigahertz, which then gets down converted and multiplied and so on. And yeah, we don't have to look at that right now. But this is the overall architecture. So you can see it's pretty straightforward. And if I open the RF section, which I intend to do because I promised I'm gonna show it to you, then we should be able to see roughly this layout through the circuit. Should be pretty interesting to take a look. And here is the detailed block diagram of this just the RF section we were looking at. Again, here's the RF input going through a 0 to 30 dB attenuator, going through a low pass filter. Here's the first mixer, first IF amplifier. Here's a band pass filter centered at 4031.25 megahertz. It has a bandwidth of 400 megahertz. That then goes into the second mixer, second IF amplifier. Now the signal is centered at 831.25 megahertz. Its bandwidth is now only 20 megahertz. And the third mixer, which then down converts to a constant 31.25 megahertz with a bandwidth of only 2 megahertz, and then directly go to the A to D converter. The clock for the A to D converter, the LO for the third mixer, the LO for the second mixer, and the first mixer all come from down here. This is all the circuitry for a synthesizer. This up here is the only difference I was talking about. If you have the 6 gigahertz version, and the difference only that the LO is multiplied, therefore the IFs coming out are also doubled as a result of that. Now if you look down here where the synthesizer is, you can see two completely independent synthesizers, with each of them with their own phase detector, loop filter, with only 30 kilohertz of bandwidth, which makes sense because they have a very clean crystal at the input. Here's the 3x VCO. It's either a third fundamental VCO or a 3x multiplier followed by the VCO. Or a VCO followed by a tripler. I'm not sure exactly. It doesn't say. And then you also have the signal coming out of the VCO. You can see it's coupled into an amplifier and coupled again, which then can be taken to the tracking generator, which I don't have. Then it goes into a divide by 32 or 64 into the a synthesizer control system, and so on and on. And here's the divider, divide and divide back chain, and so on. Here's the other synthesizer, again, similarly, has a very basic structure. This only has a fixed 1 over 4 divide here, then a 1 over 8 divide here, and then 1 over 5 divide here. And here's a temperature control crystal oscillator, which acts as a reference of everything. So the very, very basic PLL design, quite trivial, really, when you compare it to the kind of PLLs that people design today. And another interesting thing I want to show to you is this path right here, which is derived from the second synthesizer, and you can see it has a 50 megahertz output. That 50 megahertz output, they call that spider for some reason, and then that goes out, that goes onto the power management circuitry. That's why this component has to be present for the whole system to work, otherwise it wouldn't. So these two actually go back to the digital section. And here's the reference for the tracking generator, which is not drawn here. So I just wanted to give you an idea. I promised to go through it. So let's take it apart and take a look at that also. We can identify some of these blocks from the PCB. All right, and here's one side of the RF board, and here's the type N connector that comes right over here. It's on this side. Take a look, there it is. And I'm gonna try and make this steady again. Here you go, the input comes in, here's some protection, here's the input low pass filter going through the first mixer, here's the mixer and amplifier, here's the rest of the filter in between the first and second IF, here's the other mixer, more filtering again, here now the signal is around 800 megahertz going into some cavity filters. These filters are now much larger because the frequency is lower, going through our final mixer, and the final mixer output is taken over here, some adjustable ferrite inductor cores and so on to adjust the final IF bandpass filter, which is critical because this bandwidth is only 2 megahertz, so it has to be very well centered, otherwise you get attenuation. And then going through finally the analog to digital converter, and then going on the other side where the connector is. DLO distribution system, you can see all of the DLO distribution here. Here's your temperature controlled crystal oscillator, which is then used to as the reference for all the PLL components. You can see the DLO creeping in different places and coupling. Here some more couplers. Here's a coupler for the tracking generator, which then comes out of over here. Here's another mixer, which is missing, and then going through to the dub multipliers, and again all of that component is also missing because the tracking generator output would be here. None of them is populated. And on the other side of this board, we will have mostly a bunch of DC-DC converters handling all the powers and all the signals that would normally go onto every other component that you see. Here's the connector with the digital signal coming out of it. Here's some more filtering and some more coupling and some more path perhaps for the yellow. Here's an RF absorber on the other side of the second mixer. Again, more components here which are not populated and likely for the tracking generator component that's not there. Overall, as you can see, pretty straightforward microwave design. It's very nice and compact. I like it. And also it has, here's the all the components that you would expect, the compartments of all the different sections that we just looked at. Of course, all the sealing, conductive sealants have come off because they were stuck to this chassis, and when I was taking it off, they are ripped up. So now I have to very, very carefully place them back, kind of glue them in place just a tiny amount so that they stay in place when I close them. It doesn't overlap the components. If one of these things overlaps one of the microwave pieces, it's going to cause a whole bunch of problems. So I have to make sure that doesn't happen. So it looks good so far. I'm going to put it back together and then we'll go from there. And here we go. To save some time, I just basically completely reassembled it, put the correct MOSFET transistor in there that actually had a higher current handling capability than the original one that was shipped with the device, all back together. And of course it works perfectly fine. I retrofitted it with another power connector and an 18 volt power supply that I just picked up off eBay for a couple of dollars. It was an HP one that has more than enough current to supply this, and as you saw, I already tested it works perfectly fine. And in fact, it actually has a preamp option, this particular model, so it has quite a bit of a dynamic range as a result of the preamp. So I'm pretty happy with the way the repair turned out. So if you like it, leave a comment, rate the video, it always helps, and yeah, we'll go from here. Until next time.